Hello, anatomy friends. I am wildly excited to get into the appendages, and we are going to start with the superiormost appendage, or the upper limb, and then we will continue our way and finish our discussion with the lower limb. So as always, we're going to start with bones, but there are so many bones associated with the upper limb that we're going to have a few videos, and we're going to kind of break them down regarding their region. So we're going to start with the pectoral girdle. So first, we'll kind of talk about the overarching functions of the upper limb, just since this is our first video of the upper limb. But then we're going to get down into the main bones of the pectoral girdle, which are the clavicle and the scapula. Okay, so when I think of the upper limb, the first thing that comes to mind is mobility, all right? Think about moving your upper limb, and a lot of times when you move your upper limb, often you're moving that shoulder, but you can move other joints. It has considerable mobility, or more mobility than its partner down here in terms of the lower limb. So lots of mobility. There will be some other issues. So with less mobility, you're kind of giving up some of the stability, particularly in terms of the shoulder joint region. But of course, with the lower limb, it's dealing with a lot more weight than what we have in the upper limb. So lower limb is a lot more weight bearing, upper limb not so much. But it does play a very important role in terms of grasping and fine motor skills, particularly as we get to some of the more distal portions of the upper limb. We generally divide the upper limb into four major regions. We're going to have the shoulder, the arm, or the brachium. And so this whole thing is not the arm. Colloquially, we refer to the upper limb as the arm, but it's only this portion that is considered the arm, and even a little bit higher sometimes. The forearm, or the antebrachium, and then we have the hand and the wrist region right here. Okay. So returning to those superiormost portions of the upper limb bones, and that is the pectoral girdle. And this is really how we are going to have a connection to the thorax, to the upper limb. And we'll have something similar, and we talked about it with the pelvic girdle. So you have the hip bones articulating with the sacrum. Well, these two bones, the clavicle and the sternum, are not directly articulating with the vertebral column, but they are going to articulate, at least in terms of the clavicle, very directly and indirectly for the scapula, the thoracic cage. So the clavicle is this beautiful little S-shaped bone that you can palpate your own. You can palpate your clavicle almost its entire length. So it's going to be anteriorly placed right at the root of the neck region. There's that sternum right there that we are hopefully familiar with, and the ribs right here. The sternal end, as we have mentioned in previous videos, is going to articulate with the manubrium, or that superiormost portion of the sternum at the sternoclavicular joint. And then the lateral end of the bone is going to articulate with the scapula, specifically the acromion portion of the scapula. And if you follow your clavicle from medial to lateral, you can feel that bump kind of at the end there, and that is the acromioclavicular joint, or your AC joint. The clavicle is one of the most frequently fractured bones in the body. Sometimes you'll hear it referred to as the most frequently fractured, but you see different numbers on different studies, so I'm not going to say the. I'm going to say one of the most frequently fractured, and it's particularly common in children. And often what is happening is you're going to have an indirect force that is going to be transmitted from the more distal portions of the upper limb all the way up to the clavicle. So if you think of falling, and if you're falling, you often will kind of stretch out your hand to kind of stop your fall, or kind of keep your head from hitting the ground. And so that outstretched hand is going to allow for the force to kind of move up through the upper limb, and often will lead to a fracture. And usually the weakest part is going to be kind of in this junction of the middle and lateral thirds region. And with contraction of the pectoralis muscles, it could lead to the fracture getting more severe in terms of not or misaligned. So it kind of takes that immobility of a lot of the structures around there and the muscles to keep the two clavicular fractured parts close to one another to allow for healing to occur. All right, moving to the scapula. The scapula is this beautifully irregularly shaped but also flat bone or flat portion of bone right here. What you are seeing here is kind of an anterior view of the pectoral girdle, and you can see that a portion of the scapula will project anteriorly, and this is going to be the coracoid process. And you can see it quite beautifully right here. It supposedly resembles a crow's beak, and as mentioned, it's going to be superior to the glenoid cavity, which is the portion that's going to articulate with the humerus, and will project anterolaterally. And it's a process, and if you know, remember our terminology in terms of what processes are with bone, often that means it's an attachment site, and that's exactly what the coracoid process is. It will be the attachment site, or the distal attachment site, for the pectoralis minor muscle, as well as one of the heads of the biceps brachii, specifically the short head, and then all kinds of ligaments as well. We'll talk about those when we talk about the different joints in this region, particularly the acromioclavicular joint. Now, if you pat yourself on the back, you may feel this prominent projection right here, which is the spine of the scapula. So this is on the posterior surface. We're looking at a posterior view. And you'll have this dominant projection that will project posteriorly. And it will continue, and then once we get to about here-ish, we really have a name change, and the bone kind of extends and expands into the acromion, and sometimes you hear this referred to as the acromial process. And a lot of times we say this is the point of the shoulder, particularly kind of where that acromioclavicular joint happens. You can really feel that that's a nice prominent bump. You can often see it underneath an individual's skin, and so that is kind of the point of the shoulder. And oftentimes physicians will compare the two points of the shoulders to see if one is a little bit higher or a little bit lower than the other. That could have some indication of some type of shoulder pathology or something along those lines. And last but not least is the beautiful glenoid fossa. Sometimes you'll hear it referred to as the glenoid cavity. And so this is going to be where we have this is the socket portion of the glenohumeral or shoulder joint. All right. Now, look at this thing. We talked about the acetabulum when we were talking about the pelvic girdle and the hip bones. It was a fairly significantly deep structure. Compare that with this glenoid fossa right here. This fossa is relatively shallow, and the humeral head, which we'll see in some upcoming videos, is relatively large, so you do not have an excellent fit between the glenoid fossa and the head of the humerus. And so this has a lot to do with the instability, or the relative instability, of the shoulder joint and the relative mobility of the shoulder joint, just because the fit here is just not as tight as what we have in other joints. And again, this is a joint surface, so it is nice and smooth because articular cartilage would have sat there during life. All right, so our question regarding the pectoral girdle bones. The lateral continuation of the scapular spine is what osteological structure? And the structure will articulate with the clavicle. So lots and lots of clues here. Lateral continuation of the scapular spine. So it's basically of the scapular spine, just continuing laterally. And then, this is a big old hint. It articulates with the clavicle. Well, the coracoid process, there may be some ligaments that kind of head that way, but that is going to be more anteriorly placed, and it doesn't have anything to do with the scapular spine, other than being in close proximity, but not a continuation. Glenoid fossa is going to be the socket portion of the glenohumeral joint, so this is not going to be a continuation of the spine. So that leaves A, acromion or acromial process, as the correct answer. And if you're looking here, it's nice and quite obvious. You can see the spine of the scapula, and you can see it continuing and getting larger and wider as the acromion. Thank you for your time and attention here. Review these structures, and we will talk about them a little bit again when we're talking about the lab as well. Take your time, ask questions early and often, and please have a great rest of your day.